songs. They're going to do the singing of two songs, and there'll be a reading of a variety in regard to Mammon. And we'll have the service, and we'll sing two congregational songs at the end. Then Don Milton will dismiss us with prayer. Follow the leader,
Yvonne.
That I heard.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Lofty mountain grandeur,
sings my soul. My Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art. Shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art, how great
I've had an interesting week this week. It's been a very transformative week, and whenever I go through something like this, or something personal, or something exciting, I like to write it down. So I wrote something yesterday that I want to share with you guys. Almost all of my memories of Mama are of her opening doors. I remember countless occasions of being stuck somewhere in town and really needing to use the bathroom, or sitting and waiting to watch the fireworks on the 4th of July and wanting some water. So we would call Mama, ring her doorbell, and there she would be, opening the door with a huge smile on her face, welcoming us warmly, more warmly actually than I think I've ever been greeted before. For a long time, Mama served us, meaning myself and my family, always opening her door to us. But then I started working with Dinner Dash, our local church's food delivery program. Every Wednesday, I would knock on Mama's door with a to-go box in tow, waiting for that smile to greet me once more so I could feed her for another day. It was my favorite stop every single week. This last week, I've been training as an intern for a literacy program that works with underprivileged children in Greater Dallas. This week has opened my eyes to a million things, and one of those is that an actual physical door is not the only one that Mama opened for me. I remember the first time that our family went and sang at the assisted living home in which Mama was staying. I was nervous, which is weird for me because I perform all the time. But the most amazing thing ended up happening. Those people we sang to, they came back to life. They opened up their hearts to us. A woman who couldn't form a logical sentence, she was singing every word to Old Rugged Cross. A man who couldn't control his motion was tapping his foot to I'll Fly Away. My Mama, as lost as she was, she came to life every time we sang Amazing Grace or How Great Thou Art. And actually, because of my Mama, because she came to live in that home, I now know that with my future, I'll be working in music therapy to work with elderly adults like her who are suffering from disorders or diseases or health problems that come with age. Mama opened the door for my future. It's bright, and I'm very excited, and I know she would be too. I can only imagine how many doors she's opened for the people here. And so I encourage you, family and friends, to remember Mama in that light. Remember her hospitality, her infallible ability to make us laugh, and the huge smile she had every time she would open the door. She lived a beautiful, fulfilling life, and we should all strive to live a life such as this. So, we love you, Mama, and thank you for everything that you've done.
Very good, Cassie. Thank you. Everybody needs to sit down. There's still some chairs there. And when you turn to the scriptures, in 1 Chronicles chapter 7, 21 through 22, read what makes us think about common family sorrows that exist today. A father receives the news that his sons have been attacked and killed by the enemy. As the father sits stricken with sorrow, his brethren, his relatives, his friends come to mourn with him and to offer him comfort. Turn to the New Testament, John chapter 11. We find there's the sisters Mary and Martha. They have a brother Lazarus, of course, who has died. And you read concerning them that the people came to comfort them concerning their brother. And I'm sure that those in Stephenville, as well as those in Bandera, of course, have had various things to say to you. You think about the fact of the process of life, the process of death, And this particular time, my family in Bandera likes to thank Linda, and especially her and Rodney, because of all they've done for Mamaw down through time, and also for Renee and her family, and others, of course, that have been of assistance, including Debbie, our family up there. At the beginning of a service, I'd like to recall a few scriptures from God's Word. One of those is Psalms 138 and verse 6, "For the Lord be high, yet has he respect unto the lowly." And the lowly, in fact, of course, are us when you think about it. And you think further about it, notwithstanding all of God's glory and greatness, he condescends to look down upon us and to consider our needs and supply them at the time that those needs need to be met. So Peter encourages us, 1 Peter 5 and verse 7, that we cast all of our care upon the Lord because he cares for us. You go back again to the Old Testament, Psalms 8, verse 3 and 4. The psalmist, many a young man at this time, we would think, being David. "When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, a son of man that you care for him?" We can be assured, as great as God is, that in fact God cares for us. Psalms 144 and verse 3, "The Lord knows the way that we take." But Solomon said in Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 10, "The heart knows its own bitterness, and a stranger does not share its joy." And while each one of us may feel differently about the proceedings and what's going on right now, at the same time, God knows exactly how we feel. His knowing exactly, then, he's able to fulfill our needs. We read in Psalms 94, verse 17 through verse 19, "Unless the Lord had been my help, my soul would soon have settled in silence. If I say my foot slips, your mercy, O Lord, will hold me up. At the multitude of my anxieties within me, your comfort delights my soul." So Christ enables us to look beyond the conflicts of this time to the glories of eternal life. It lifts our hearts above those things which are temporal and temporary, to things that are spiritual, to things that are eternal. When you go again to the New Testament, 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 10, Christ has abolished death and brought immortality to light through the gospel. So we find that, as Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, for the Christian, death has lost its sting. And for that fact, then we can thank the Lord that while there's still sorrow, while there's still mixed emotions, all of which pertain to our human makeup, that we have here upon this earth. It calls, of course, to us the fact of Jesus suffering in the Garden of Gethsemane. We find he was in great sorrow there, as it reads. He's concerned his approaching death and wondering if it's possible, in fact, that cup of suffering, that cup of death, pass him by. And so he prays, "If it be possible, Lord, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And that's why we have hope, because Christ submitted his will unto the Father's will and went to the cross on our behalf. He came to do his Father's will. He saw it on more than one occasion. He committed himself to doing it, which led him, of course, to the sacrifice for us today. Melbourne Lynch was born on June the 16th, 1924, to John Ellis and Zora Wade Martin. She passed away on May the 27th at the age of 91. She was preceded in death by her husband, Charles Lynch, and she's going to be buried next to him, as we see here. Also by one son, Donald Eugene Smith, by one grandson, Gary Smith, by one sister, Mildred Macklin, by one brother, James Martin. She was survived by two sons, myself, Martin, and my wife, Marianna Bandero, by another son, Ronaldine Smith of El Cajon, California, by one daughter, Linda Fender, and her husband, Rodney, by one sister, Bobby Hawthorne, and she wasn't able to come today, by 10 grandchildren, and also by 18 great-grandchildren. If you're not part of the family, then you might think some of what I'm going to say is unusual today. And if you are family, then you may hear some things that you maybe never really give thought to. At least in my family, there are a lot of things that we've never discussed about our childhood or the times that we lived with our mother or things of that nature. And some things I'm going to say by supposition, by having known Mamaw and thinking about why sometimes she did things that she would do. Probably when we were young, and that means, in my case, less than 9 years old, and Linda younger than that, and that's when we made our entrance in the Bowles Home for Children. Now, I would think prior to that, And we live in a, what they call a dysfunctional family. I have no doubt, in fact, that's what it was. We don't remember too much about our home life, nor our uncles, nor our aunts, because we were seldom with any of them. Whereas you think about the blessing of knowing your uncles and aunts today, and even your grandparents sometimes, we find that many never know who their grandparents are because they passed on before you come along. But our father was an alcoholic. My understanding was that he was the best mechanic in the city of Greenville, Texas. And every weekend, he'd get drunk, end up in jail. His boss would bail him out so he could work for him Monday through Friday. Then the same thing, it's just kind of like a repeat. It happened over and over. Well, I've never drank in my life, not because my dad said not do it, but because you look at the example he set, and we'll find it says, you'll ruin everything you have. Not that we think everything's been ruined, but at the same time, we'll find it will ruin everything you have. The scriptures say it, examples say it. And I would think in our mother's case, having four children, living in that kind of situation would be living a life of havoc, day in and day out. Nothing sure, no security about this or that, not knowing what in fact might happen day by day, unable to provide and care for those who are your own. So as Linda and I look back at our past, knowing very little about that, we never really discussed that, by the way, as far as that goes. And we believe that we were fortunate to have lived at that children's home at that time and to grow up there in our youth. We'll find that that got us out of that particular environment. Our grandparents, by chance, the Martin family, they were house parents there. Our grandfather worked on the farm at that particular place. So we have no complaints. We have a good life, we feel like, and things are well in our families. And when we think about that, in contrast, we look around at our families today. Not that we're perfect, but that basically we are, I would say, a good family. We all have jobs. Some of us are Christians, but basically we're living a good life so far as life on earth is concerned. And I'm not going to take time to, but take time to read Psalms 127 and Psalms 128. One of that, Psalms 127 starts, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain to build it. And the rest of that psalm and the next psalm actually complements the fact of having a family. So during our time at the children's home, our mother took a job working. She did a lot of things, by the way. I can remember her working at a restaurant as a waitress, but she took a lot of jobs. Finally, she got to work at Hager's. Hager's is a clothing company. If you don't know, they're still in business, by the way. And we'll find that, anyhow, she worked there for 30 years and retired from that company. So that was really a blessing in her life. Also, she met and married Charles Lynch, and that was on March 1969, who was apparently a very good choice for her. He provided for her a place to live, enabled her to have something in life, we'll say, got rid of that state of insecurity that no doubt she felt. Now, after she passed away, well, I suggest that those first emotions left, but things still changed. And we'll find she had concerns that had not been hers for several years. And because of the things, what I suppose, again, one of her obsessions was owning a house. She was always concerned about owning a house. That's one reason she had difficulty going to the assisted living. What happens to my house? I need that house, you know. And we actually provided three sources of what we would do to help her because she became unable to take care of herself. My foot got stuck in the mud, by the way.
That's all right.
And so anyhow, she was unable to take care of herself, as we all know. So that's why she ended up living in that particular place. And we ought to be concerned about having a place to live. Every day I pray that my family will realize the blessing of having a place to stay at night and to have a good night's rest. That is a blessing. And we'll find that a lot of people don't have that. And sometimes we don't know that. We will find she was somewhat concerned about money, probably because there was a time when we'll say she didn't know where money was coming from, even apart from the time of the Depression. And we'll find that one of the things we know that she really loved was dogs. And when she and Charles got married, right off they had two dogs, Susie and Sugar, and they were little white poodles. Of course, those poodles were treated like royalty by them. Eventually, they died, and there was a vow that they'd never have another dog. Well, meanwhile, they moved to another subdivision, and they had a local dump, so they went down to take the trash out, and there's a little dog down there. The dog wouldn't come to them, but they started feeding that dog. Finally, the dog came to them. That was their next royalty, by the way. They named her Annie. And we'll find they treated her just like they did those two poodles. After moving to Stephenville, then she was still concerned she didn't have any dogs. She was concerned about her neighbor's dogs. If you knew where she lived, well, she had about four neighbors. And we'll find that some of them had dogs sometimes, sometimes they didn't have dogs. But she always wanted to take care of those dogs because she knew the owners didn't. They didn't feed them properly. They didn't give them the loving they needed and all that kind of business, you know. So we'll find that she would feed them through the fence. So she enjoyed doing that. Well, you might know about one incident. There was a guy named Roderick that lived, I think he was a coach in Stephenville, I think. And he lived next door. He had a little wiener dog, if I remember what it was. But anyhow, she was feeding that dog through the fence. And she got bit in the process, or at least scratched by that dog. And so she knew it was just excited about having something to eat because he'd been starving. And so she ended up going, Rodney and Linda took her to the ER room. And of course, anytime you have a dog incident, you're going to have a law incident. So they called the law, and they came up there, and then she has to make a decision. She had Roderick's dog, what do you call it? Guarantee a quarantine. Do you have his dog quarantined, or what? Well, she decided that Roderick maybe took better care of it than that, so she let it go back home. But anyhow, the law was now involved in that, in the fact of what happened. But she also enjoyed shopping, and Aunt Bobby, who some of you know and some of you don't know, way back there, when Town East was first built to the city of Mesquite, well, they'd go shopping every Saturday. It was just a thing. Her husband said, that's what those girls do. So they go to Mesquite, they'd eat dinner over there, of course, then come back to the house in the evening. And we'll find that that's one thing she enjoyed doing. She did like to buy clothes, by the way. And she liked to spend cash doing that rather than a credit card. But sometimes she would outspend her cash, by the way. Mm-hmm. And so Yvonne, we can thank her for bringing her down several times to Bandera to see us. Then we'd make a trip into San Antonio. It has to be Dillard's or Macy's or somewhere like that because that's the kind of clothes that she liked to wear. And again, she normally brought cash. And Mary Ann and Yvonne would help her pick out this and that. Say, yes, you need that? No, you don't need that. And we'll find that there she sometimes pick according to what their opinion might be. So she also enjoyed going to SAS Shoe Factory. You ought to do that at least once in your life. But if you've never been there, do it once. You don't need to go back again unless you're a woman. But yeah, she'd buy three or four pair of shoes at that time, you know. She enjoyed coming to Camp Bandina, where they have an old folks, I call it, event at the Bandina. It's called the Golden Agers. And now it's actually staged out of Brownwood when it comes to Bandera. And she and Marianne, Yvonne, and Cynthia, they'd come down there and have a good time. And they'd stay most of the time what we call the River House, which is the place we own in that location. But I sometimes think back about Mother. You know, how well does she really hear? And how well does she really see? And sometimes, I don't think she heard as well as we thought she did. She could hear you whisper, by the way, because you're always talking about her. But nonetheless, we'll find that if you were talking out loud, then you were probably not being heard very well. But anyhow, whether she could see well or hear well, we know, of course, that there's sometimes that she didn't always enjoy some things that we enjoy. But one night, we were at our house. We were watching the Wild Hogs. That's those four guys on those motorcycles. And she sat there and she died laughing at that movie. Funniest thing she'd ever seen in her life. And so I thought, you know, it was a very good event for us because she was really enjoying it. But one thing we see, of course, in the fact of her life is the power of mind, for good or for bad. We find that we all have powerful minds. We can develop those minds. Those minds can deteriorate as well. We know, of course, in her case that it did deteriorate. It took its toll in her life. I'm not too sure what the obsession with washing machines was, but she owned more than we'll ever own in our life. And she owned more TVs than we'll ever own in our life. I don't care how much larger they get, how much better they get, we'll probably not have as many as she did. And we'll find that that was one of the things that she thought she needed, and needed badly, you know. But with all this, we find that our belief as a Christian is that you have a home with God, eternal in the heavens. And the Christian has promised this over and over, of course, in the Scriptures. She's gone through the physical death, which is inevitable for each one of us as we read in the Scriptures as well. Some have viewed that with dread and with fear, but I read a passage a moment ago that says that's all taken out of the way because of the fact of Jesus Christ. And on more than one occasion, our mother said, you know, I would just like to lay down, go to sleep, and not wake up. And apparently, that's what happened in this case. And so what a blessing it turns out to be when you think about it realistically. Reality is, there are some things worse than death. When we think about that, that's a serious statement. We'll find that each one of us are made in the image of God. And that means that we have a soul. We have that which is eternal. And thinking about that passage, as we read a moment ago, as we die, our spirit goes back to God from whence it came, we read in Ecclesiastes 12. And the body returns to the dust from whence it came. The psalmist said in Psalms 116 and verse 15, precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his saints. Well, it doesn't matter, you know. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. One passage I like to read is in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, again in verse 16. Therefore, he says, we do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, like it or not, each one of us are perishing, by the way. Our outward man is perishing, he says, but the inward man is being renewed day by day. He's talking positive there. Sometimes our inward man is not being renewed, but we want to be what God wants us to be. Our inward man is being renewed day by day. Our light affliction, that's what we're experiencing, by the way. Our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. For we do not look at the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen. The things which are seen are temporary. The things which are not seen are eternal. You look around, everything you see is temporary. Everything right here, you, well, except for the fact that we have an eternal soul. The flesh is temporary. We read on, Paul, here's where he really gets confident. For we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, and we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this body, we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from God. If indeed, having been clothed, we should not be found naked. We are who in this tent, this body, we groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up by life. Now he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has also given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So we're confident, knowing that while we're at home in the body, we're absent from the Lord. We walk by faith and not by sight. We're confident, yes, well pleased, rather, to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. Therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, that we're well pleasing unto God. We all will appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one of us may receive the things done in our body, according to whether it be good or according to whether it be bad. And so you think about what he says, think about that moaning and groaning, and we'll find, I guess, every one of us do. But I think about, my statement sometimes is, someone, how are you doing? My statement usually is, well, I can moan and groan with the best. And we'll find that most of us find ourselves doing that, of course, time after time. And we'll find that death is a transition to a better life. And ours is that we be ready to move on. So we're just simply changing worlds. The Christian goes from that which is temporal to that which is eternal. He goes from that group, goes from that place of suffering and agony to one of happiness. I just like to read three passages that are short in that regard. Revelation chapter 7, 16 and 17. Verse 15. Therefore, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. He who sits on the throne will dwell among them. They shall neither hunger anymore, nor thirst anymore. The sun shall not strike them, nor any heat. But the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of waters. And God shall wipe away every tear from their eyes. Going over to Revelation then, chapter 14 and verse 13. John says, I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow after them. And going from that to Revelation 21, I believe it's verse 4, and it is verse 4, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying, no more pain, for the former things have passed away. The former things of her life have passed away. She's changed locations, and that location, of course, is eternal, that which she's gone. And I conclude with Ecclesiastes 12 and verse 13. Let us hear the conclusion of the matter. We've talked about life, we've talked about death, that's what Solomon did. Let us hear the conclusion of the matter. Let us reverence God and keep his commandments. That's the whole of man. That's the whole of our life. to keep God's commands. So we think about the fact, again, of life, the expressions that come to us because of death, and the sorrow that we feel, but there are things far better again, and the sorrow that we experience. This time we're going to have two congregational songs, and then Don Milton's going to dismiss us in prayer.
We brought some books for you. We'll start out with page 313, 313.
These are a couple of other Mamaw's favorites.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world rich trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world as a wondrous attraction for me, for the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the
special. They're all special, as Cassie said, they're all special to us, but this is what Uncle Martin was talking about. You know, we're eventually going to fly away, and doesn't mean that things don't hurt, but it means that we've got a better life ahead. So join us with this.
Somewhere morning when the strife is over, I lay my way to a home on God's blessed shore. I'll fly away, fly away, fly away, when the shadows are
Heavenly Father, we come to you now and we're humbled. We're also thankful for a life that's been well lived, Father. I thank you so much for Mamaw, for Melbourne. Father, just thank you so much for the encouragement that she was to so many people, opening her doors, being who it is that you would have her to be, Father. We thank you for life. We thank you for the gift, Father. Thank you for all that you do for us. Father, we just pray and ask that as we go from here today, that we'll continue to share those wonderful thoughts and memories that we have of Mamaw, Father, and that we'll continue to be an encouragement to one another and a blessing to one another. Father, I thank you for the comforter that you send. I thank you for your Holy Spirit that helps us to understand and helps us to work through things that are very difficult, very challenging for us. Father, I thank you for the words of Martin and of Cassie and the great remembrances that they have brought and for the message that they brought. Father, I just pray and ask that you'll be with this special family today. They're very dear to us. Pray that you'll watch over them, that you'll keep them safe. As we go from here, we lift all these things up to you in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.